Since weeds are so prevalent in many areas of the landscape or cropping system, management techniques are necessary to maintain order. Weed management is most successful when it involves an integrated approach using a variety of methods. The common methods used to maintain weeds include prevention in cultural, mechanical, biological with limited uses, and chemical means. I'm Dr. Nabusk, and in this video, I'm going to discuss integrated weed management strategies. Weed control within the first several weeks after crops are planted is critical in order to avoid a yield reduction from weeds. The effectiveness of any weed control program depends largely on timeliness of the control. Preventative, cultural, mechanical, and chemical weed management methods all are most effective if applied at the correct time. Fields that are kept free of weeds for the first several weeks after planting give the crop a competitive edge that allows the crop to shade out or outcompete weeds that emerge later in the season. Accurate weed identification is the first step to successfully manage weeds. Since weeds vary in their ability to compete with crops and reduce yields and also vary in their response to different management strategies, proper identification is essential to develop effective management plans. Many universities publish weed guides in various growing systems. There are four main systems of controlling weeds: preventative, not letting weeds become established; cultural, practices like adjusting planting date that aid or deter weed development; mechanical, cultivation or hand pulling as examples; and chemical, herbicide application. The following are several preventative cultural practices that do not allow weeds to become established and spread. Control weeds in non-cropland areas, including fence rows, drainage ditch banks, and right-of-ways. Plant only high-quality weed-free crop seed. Do not spread manure, hay, or crop residues contaminated with weed seed on cropland. Clean farm machinery between fields to avoid transport of weed seed, rhizomes, tubers, and rootstocks. And if new or unfamiliar weeds appear, have them identified quickly and take appropriate control measures if necessary. Cultural and crop management techniques provide a healthy crop to best compete with weeds. Crop competition can be an inexpensive and effective aid to weed management if used to its fullest advantage. Examples of cultural techniques include following soil test recommendations for fertilizer and lime, selecting the best crop varieties, planting dense crop populations at the proper timing, scouting fields regularly for weeds, insects, and diseases and controlling them when necessary, adequate drainage and seed treatments. Most corn is treated with seed treatments. Soybeans may need seed treatments to help with early season growth, especially if planting early in the season. Other agronomic practices that have been shown to help control weed populations are crop rotation and timing of the planting date. By rotating crops, farmers can control seed production and or plant establishment. Continuation of a monoculture system selects for weed species adapted to those particular management practices. Rotation of crop choice allows for diversification of herbicide modes of action to be incorporated into a system and disrupts the favorable environment of the predominant weed species in the system. Early planting dates of crops not only offer the possibility of increased yield, but also allow the crop valuable growing time without competition from weed seedlings. When weed seeds begin to emerge, crops have already become well established and are less affected by seedling competition. Weed seedlings remain at a disadvantage due to limited resources and may not survive to produce seed. Late planting of crops also offers a benefit by allowing weed seed to germinate and be destroyed prior to crop planting. For large agricultural productions, cover crops remain the most widely used form of ground cover. The use of cover crops also has been reported to reduce weed seedling growth through allelopathy or chemical inhibition. These practices make use of altering the growing conditions within or on the soil surface in order to increase weed seedling mortality and reduce competitive pressure on the crop. Mechanical weed control involves physically disrupting the environment around the weeds. This can be accomplished by using tillage to disrupt vegetative and seed reproduction, using cultivation or rotary hoeing to kill emerged weeds, mowing weeds to cut off reproductive structures and or decrease food storage and energy reserves, and mulching to inhibit germination of weed seeds. Tillage of agricultural land targets the weed seed bank and often reduces weed seedling emergence due to seed burial or early germination in adverse conditions. In more recent years, however, the adoption of conservation tillage has reduced the dependency on tillage. In these reduced tillage systems, increased weed seed mortality may also be achieved by allowing weed seed to remain exposed and vulnerable to greater predation. In either instance, the agricultural practice effectively modifies characteristics of weed population dynamics in order to reduce the weed population within a region. Mowing is one of the most common mechanical control, and it is more effective on annual broadleaf weeds. Mulching, plastic covers, and cover crop incorporation can lend to suppression of weed seedling emergence by reducing light penetration to the soil surface, thus inhibiting seedling growth. Mulches and plastic coverings are usually limited to gardens and high-value systems like plant propagation and tomatoes. Biological weed control involves the use of other living organisms such as insects, diseases, or livestock for the management of certain weeds. In theory, biological control is well suited for an integrated weed management program. However, the limitations of biological control are that it is a long-term undertaking, its effects are neither immediate nor always adequate, only certain weeds are potential candidates, and the rate of failure for past biological control efforts has been fairly high. There have been a few success stories of weed species being managed with insect or disease biological agents, but normally it is in natural areas or pastures. Herbivores, such as sheep or goats, can provide successful control of some common pasture weeds. Research continues in this area of weed management. Chemical weed control involves the use of herbicides to suppress or kill weeds. There are many different herbicides available, and some knowledge about how particular herbicides work is necessary before applying herbicides. Herbicides kill plants by interfering with various vital plant processes. For example, they may interfere with photosynthesis, inhibit root or shoot growth, or induce abnormal plant tissue development. Often closely related herbicides exhibit the same mode of action, but there are exceptions. Knowing the mode of action helps in recognizing damage symptoms caused by a specific herbicide on target weeds as well as on non-target plants. Modes or mechanisms of action for specific herbicides can be found on the Herbicide Resistance Action Committee website or from the Weed Science Society of America. Proper choice of herbicide depends on the weed species or species complex, the susceptibility of the weeds to the material, and the tolerance of the crop and surrounding desirable vegetation to the material. Herbicide rate and application timing are always important factors to consider when using herbicides. Herbicides are classified in several ways, generally relating to how they affect plants or which types of plants they affect. Herbicides that kill weeds but leave desirable plants unharmed are called selective. For instance, certain herbicides kill most broadleaves but leave grassy plants such as turf or grain crops unharmed. Know the identity of the weed species to take advantage of herbicide selectivity. Selectivity can also be achieved by placing materials away from crops or applying them before crop plants emerge or after they are vulnerable to damage. Proper timing and placement, therefore, is essential for the successful use of herbicides. Applying no more than the prescribed rate is also important since many herbicides lose selectivity when applied at too high a rate, and applying herbicides above legal rate is illegal. Non-selective herbicides control green plants regardless of species. They are generally used to kill all plants, such as in the renovation or establishment of a new turf area, as a spot treatment, or to trim along sidewalks. Glyphosate, glufosinate, and dicquat are examples of non-selective herbicides. These herbicides injure most plants. Therefore, in an established system, their use is usually limited to spot applications for weedy patches. A burn-down treatment that is used to control all vegetation prior to crop emergence is another example of non-selective herbicide use. Some herbicides have the ability to move throughout the plant, systemic or translocated, and others damage only the parts of the plant that are sprayed on, contact. Soil-applied herbicides enter plants through roots, shoots, seeds, rhizomes, bulbs, or tubers. The primary site of entry for foliar-applied herbicides is the leaf. Once inside the plant, the herbicide must reach a specific susceptible site. Contact herbicides typically kill only the tissue that is sprayed. Repeat applications are often needed with contact herbicides to kill regrowth from these underground plant parts. Examples of contact herbicides include bentazone, glufosinate, and dicquat. Systemic herbicides move in the xylem that conducts water and nutrients, or they move in the phloem with the sugars. Xylem translocated herbicides move upward and outward. They cannot move down the plant and affect older leaves first. Phloem translocated herbicides become distributed throughout the plant. Immediate effects include contact burn and distortion, and chronic effects include inhibitions of new shoot tips, young leaves, and buds. Systemic herbicides generally are slower acting and kill plants over a period of days. Examples of systemic herbicides include glyphosate, 2,4-D, dicamba, imazoquin, metsulfuron, and cethoxidim. Understanding the site of entry and whether and how herbicides are translocated is essential when choosing herbicides and also aids in determining appropriate application timing and herbicide placement. Herbicide applications are made at different times depending on the herbicide crop and weeds present and crop and weed growth stages. Herbicide programs typically include soil applied, for example, pre-emergence, and post-emergence products. Soil applied herbicides control weeds as seeds germinate, reducing early season weed competition and protecting yield potential. They also provide residual activity and greater flexibility in timing of post-emergence herbicides. Factors particularly important to consider for soil-applied products include soil type, environmental impacts such as leaching or runoff potential, and possible interactions with insecticides or other herbicides. Rates should be based on soil type, target weeds, and objectives for the application. Full season weed control versus setup for planned post-emergence herbicide. Irrigation before and after application is necessary to activate most pre-emergence herbicides. Pre-emergence herbicides are generally effective in controlling weeds from 6 to 12 weeks following application. Most herbicides begin to degrade soon after application when exposed to the environment. Therefore, to obtain season-long control, an additional application should follow 6 to 9 weeks after the initial one. Post-emergence herbicide applications target weed species not controlled by soil applications. Some post-emergence herbicides only control weeds emerged at the time of application. Others control emerged weeds and provide residual activity against later emerging weeds. Field scouting is particularly important when selecting post-emergence herbicides. Fields should be scouted frequently following crop emergence to determine the need and appropriate timing of post-emergence weed control. Weed species density and growth rate are critical factors influencing how long weeds can compete with the crop before yields are reduced. Treat fields with heavy infestations as soon as possible after weeds emerge. The initial growth of weeds is relatively slow, but their growth rate increases rapidly as time progresses. Weeds as small as 2 inches tall can reduce crop yields if present at high densities. Crop yield loss per day increases due to increasing competition of larger weeds. Post-emergence herbicide effectiveness is reduced when the weed is under drought stress, cold stress, or has begun to produce seeds, or is mowed before the chemical has time to work, several days after application. Avoid application when these detrimental growing conditions exist. A well-designed weed management plan involves field scouting and protects crops from weed competition, prevents weed populations from increasing over time, minimizes herbicide injury, and delays or prevents herbicide-resistant weed development. When selecting herbicides, consider the weed problems from the previous year and herbicide-tolerant crops used, such as Roundup Ready cotton or soybean. Consider environmental conditions from the previous year, including conditions favorable for herbicide carryover. Carryover injury depends on the herbicide concentration in the soil and the susceptibility of the intended rotational crop to that herbicide. The primary mechanism of degradation of most herbicides is by soil microbial processes, which are reduced by dry conditions. Considerations for the current year when selecting herbicides includes the weeds present, herbicide-tolerant crop plans, and plans for tillage. You should also consider using herbicides with different sites of action to delay or prevent herbicide-resistant weed development and using timely herbicide applications that prevent early season weed competition and provide residual control for late emerging weed species. Herbicide choice also depends on crop rotation plans for the next year to evaluate carryover. You must also look at post-emergence herbicide label restrictions based on the crop and weed growth stage and/or height. In conclusion, weed management is vital for maximizing crop production. Accurate weed identification is the first step to successfully managing weeds. Because weed species vary in their response to different management strategies, proper identification is essential to develop effective management plans. These plans include preventative, cultural, mechanical, or chemical control methods that are specific to the particular cropping system and the weeds present. Control methods must be employed at the appropriate time for optimum results.